And I'm still learning myself. I mean, it's not like EOS has been around for several years, and there's a lot of best practices and a lot of documentation out there. Full transparency, I do own some EOS tokens, and I'm interested in this because I want to build dApps on EOS. That's the reason why I'm here, and that's the reason why I took the initiative to found EOS Vienna. So I would like to get to know the audience a little bit. So who here among the audience is a developer? Please raise your hands. Okay, so almost everybody. That's very good. Who has developed on EOS already? Okay, very good. One person, very good. You want to come up here and help me? Maybe next time. Who has developed on Ethereum? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, so quite a few people, 9 or 10 people. Who has developed on other blockchains, other than Ethereum and EOS? Okay, yeah, quite a few people, very good. Who's an entrepreneur, if you're not a developer? Okay. Okay, so 5 or 6. And among you, who wants to build on EOS? Okay, pretty cool. All right, so we start with some naming clarifications, yes? So when we talk about EOS, what do I mean by it? Yeah, so EOS can be the name of the EOS token, and it can be the name of the ERC20 token that we have right now, sitting in an Ethereum smart contract, or it could also be the name of the EOS token in the EOS mainnet once it launches. But it's also the name of the mainnet, which is a community-operated network. Okay, and it's based on the EOS.io software. Yes, so EOS is the blockchain, is the network, and EOS.io is the software, and that's an important distinction, because the software is developed by Block One, and Block One is the company that's doing this ICO. It's open source on GitHub, and it's used by the EOS mainnet. And WEX, I don't know if you know the WEX digital asset exchange, they have announced that they're going to switch to the EOS platform, but not to the EOS mainnet, but they're going to deploy their own version of the EOS.io software, and possibly some others as well that I'm not aware of. But the EOS.io software is developed in a way that makes it usable not just for the mainnet, but also for private installations, yeah, in the same way as Ethereum. So since many of you are familiar with Ethereum, I've prepared a little comparison sheet here. So obviously the most striking difference is the consensus mechanism. So Ethereum obviously is proof of work, and EOS is BFT DPoS, and this stands for Byzantine Fault Tolerant Delegated Proof of Stake. Sounds very complicated. So Ethereum 15 to 30 transactions per second. I don't know if that's correct. I tried to Google it.
Depends on the kind of transaction.
Yeah, but generally it's in this. Yeah, so it's somewhere 30 transactions per second. For the main chain of EOS, it's going to be around 1,000 in the beginning. They're still working on optimizations like multi-threading, will not be enabled from the start. So the initial tests were at around 1,000 transactions per second for very simple transfers. Obviously not all transactions are the same, so it could also be less. We have on Ethereum, we have the Ethereum virtual machine. On EOS, we have WebAssembly. So in theory, any language that can be compiled to WebAssembly can be used for smart contract development. At the moment, this is only C++. First of all, because this is the only stable compiler. There's a Rust compiler as well, and I think some people are trying to port over the EOS lib to Rust so that eventually you're going to be able to use Rust as well. And one of the most striking differences is the block time for EOS, which is only 500 milliseconds. Yeah? So it means every 500 milliseconds there is a new block, which means you get very quick confirmations. Then another striking difference is there are no transaction fees. Means you don't need gas to interact with a smart contract. And then another difference is on Ethereum we have, it's pretty obvious that the law paradigm is code. So code is the law. And if there's a bug in the code, this bug is law as well. And on EOS, there's a, it's the chain of the rule of law, basically. So, so you have things like recurring contracts, and you can, in fact, change the code of smart contracts, as long as the recurring contract stays the same, which lets you fix bugs. There's also a form of dispute resolution on built-in on EOS. It's called arbitration. I know on Ethereum there's a similar project. It's called Materium that you can use if you want something like that. And on EOS there is no native token. There is no such thing as Ether. And in fact, if you deploy a private version of the EOS.io software, you don't even need a token at all. You could just use it as a distributed database and never use a token. Yes, so on there's a token standard, there's a 20 on Ethereum that we all know and love, and on EOS there's something similar and it's called EOS.io.token. So consensus. So we said it's Byzantine fault tolerant delegated proof of stake. And this means that there are 21 block producers that are elected by the community. And they are taking turns producing blocks. So the EOS.io software requires, won't run on your laptop, so it requires high-end hardware to run. So the server farm that these block producers are going to have to run is quite a big and heavy infrastructure. And those 21 block producers will compensate it for this work by inflation. So 1% per annum inflation is going to pay these block producers. So there are 21 main block producers who are active at any given moment of time, and there could be any number of backup producers. And some of them even will get paid for being a stand-up block producer. So as I said, the block producers, the 21, are voted in by the token holders, and anyone who has staked EOS tokens can vote for these block producers. So if any of those block producers behave in a Byzantine way or sign blocks, sign double blocks or anything like that, behave in any way maliciously, they can be quickly voted out and replaced by any of the backup producers. And so obviously this is a very different approach than Ethereum, and since there are 21 block producers that you can name, many people argue that this system is not as decentralized and it is not as censorship resistant as Ethereum system. But there are a couple of delegated proof of stake blockchains running, like BitShares and Steam. Arguably, they don't have that high of a market cap, so it's probably not such a high bounty, such a big bounty, but still, the system is somewhat tested in a way. And it might still work well enough in practice. But we will see, because the mainnet has not launched yet, so this is something that will be very interesting to follow in the upcoming weeks and months and years, how well the system will be able to defend itself against attacks by governments, hackers, and such. Yeah. So mainnet launch will hopefully be on the 2nd of June, which will be like the day after tomorrow or something. And this is done in a way by which the EOS.io software, in the terms of use, it states that you can only start using this software legally after June 2nd. Which means on June 2nd, the community can take the code and use it to launch the mainnet. So here is an infographic that was made by one of the block producer candidates, and it was shown to it was made to show that Ethereum and Bitcoin are not as decentralized as some people claim. And here the claim is that if you look at Ethereum, and you can see the blue, red, and orange block, mining pools together have more than 51% of the hash rate. So in fact, only three mining pools control the hash rate of Ethereum. And on Bitcoin, it's a little bit better. It's the top four mining pools. And on EOS, it is 21 in total, and I think 15, so up to 15 of those need to stay in consensus. So arguably, EOS is even more decentralized than Ethereum or Bitcoin. We can discuss this, yeah? So if you are of a different opinion, I'm happy to hear your arguments. Yeah, so, and obviously EOS does this all to achieve a certain speed and scalability that we are not seeing right now on Ethereum. And so we have a block time of 500 milliseconds. There are no transaction fees, no gas. So how is it that we cannot spam the network? It is rate limited based on stake, yes? So if you own a certain number of EOS tokens, you get a certain number or a certain amount of bandwidth in terms of CPU computation power and bandwidth that you can use. And if you want to use storage, you can buy also storage, smart contract storage with your EOS tokens. But the tokens will not get consumed. Yes? So for as long as you are using this bandwidth, you need to stake those tokens. When you're done, you can unstake the tokens and get them back. They are not consumed. You just need to hold them for as long as you need the storage or bandwidth. Yes, so 1,000 transactions per second is not a lot, arguably. And EOS has a roadmap of scaling with sidechains and multi-threading. So there is an inter-blockchain communication protocol built in, and you can deploy several EOS chains, and they can communicate with each other with very low latency. Round trip takes 3 seconds for inter-blockchain communication. And so if you have like a high throughput transaction that you don't want to put on the mainnet, you can put it on the sidechain, and you can regularly communicate with the main chain by means of the inter-blockchain communication protocol. Yeah, so here are some random features. So EOS, as said, is a blockchain of law. So there's a constitution that every user has to agree to. It's like the terms of service, basically. There are Ricardian contracts that you can attach to smart contracts. There is a process for changing smart contract code in order to fix bugs. There are easy upgrades and bug recovery. There are human readable account names. There's a process for recovery from stolen keys. So if your private key gets stolen by someone, there's a process to recover your account. You can delegate capacity, which means if you own EOS tokens, you can lease them out or rent them out to dApp developers who need the tokens and earn passive income. And there are, I know Vitalik Buterin said otherwise, but there are actually Merkle groups for like client validation. And this is something that is needed for inter-blockchain communication, because the way this is implemented is that you're going to have a smart contract that acts as a light client for a different blockchain. And this way, you can communicate between blockchains. All right, so what is the EOS token? It's currently an ERC20 token on Ethereum. It will be an EOS.io token, and an EOS.io.token is the EOS token standard, okay? So it's the equivalent of the ERC20 token standard. And this token needs to be staked for access to blockchain resources. As I said, the token is not consumed, can be unstaked when you're done. It can also be used for block producer voting. And there are airdrops also on EOS. So a lot of projects have already announced that they are going to airdrop their token to anyone who is holding EOS tokens. So distributed applications is what I'm interested in the most. So when you're building a user interface directly on EOS, you can have 250 milliseconds average confirmation time, which means it's fast enough, so the user clicks something, a transaction gets mined, and you immediately see the result on the web page. And this, for the first time, lets you build truly interactive user interfaces, where you immediately see the result of your actions. You don't need to wait until it is mined. You don't need to choose the gas fees and the gas price in Gwei or something like that. You don't need to deal with that. And app developers have a choice. So they can either require their users to bring their own EOS tokens. So the bandwidth that the user consumes by interacting with the application is sort of paid by the user themselves. Or alternatively, the app can stake the tokens for the user. Yeah? So if I, for example, want to build a social network or something, and I want to open it up for anyone who doesn't even own any EOS tokens, I can do it. It just means I need to buy, as an application developer, I need to buy more EOS tokens and stake more of them because my users are not going to stay there. So EOS offers a multi-index database API for distributed applications, and also offers a storage solution based on IPFS for bigger files. And the block producers are going to have to replicate the files in their data centers. So they are responsible for replicating the data. And if you want to store something on EOS.io storage, also here again, the same, you need to stake a certain amount of tokens. And for this, you get X amount of megabytes of storage. And when you don't need the storage anymore, you can delete the file and get your tokens back. So there are going to be additional query services by block producers. And this could look like this. So this is a graphics from block one. So any of this is not finished yet. So this is future. Because a typical application needs a secondary database most of the time. For example, if you need to make aggregation queries, if you need to make geolocation queries or anything like that. So any serious web application that's going to have lots of traffic is going to have, like, will not pull the data from the blockchain every time somebody visits the website. They're going to have something like MongoDB or a classical SQL database or something like that, where the data is replicated and caching and stuff like that. And the idea on EOS.io is that block producers are going to provide a certain amount of extra infrastructure that distributed applications need. So that in theory, you could just build your app with HTML and JavaScript, deploy it in IPFS, and then you would need no server at all. You could do everything directly with the EOS system. You would not need to deploy any secondary databases on a centralized server or anything. Okay, so we're now gonna develop an application together, a very simple blogging platform, decentralized blogging platform. And now I actually need a chair because I cannot type while standing. I'll just do this one. And before we do that, let me quickly explain to you the development toolchain. Yes, so the development toolchain is very, very simple. So these are all the steps, the only steps required to deploy a smart contract on EOS. Yes, so you write your smart contract, then you compile the C++ code to WebAssembly, then you generate an ABI file, and then you deploy it to the chain. So these are all the necessary steps. These are very simple commands. You don't even need an IDE or anything like that. Okay, so now we have a live demo. So we're gonna create a very simple blogging platform in 15 minutes. Let's see if that works. If I can leave the browser. All right. Okay. So we're going to create our directory, and in it we are going to create our C++ file, and we're going to open this up in a text editor. Now actually I need my cheat sheet to make sure, just in case I forget something. I actually have a cheat sheet. sheet and paper. Make this a little bigger. Okay. All right, so we're gonna include EOS.io lib, EOS.io.php. So this is the header, and we're going to use the namespace EOS.io, and we're going to import namespace standard as well to save some typing. And then we create a new class. To write in a constructor that takes the account name of the owner or the creator of this contract. Okay. And then we are going to create a struct, and this struct will serve as our database table. So here we can define our database, our data structure. Yeah. So, and since we want to create a blogging platform, we're gonna call this blog. And the first field that we're going to have will be an ID. And IDs are always unsigned 64-bit integers. And then we're going to store the account name of the author. And by account name, this is really the EOS account name, okay? And then we're going to store a string. We're going to store the title of the blog post. And we're going to store the HTML code. And then we need to specify a function that gives us the primary key. And we define this ID. Up until very recently, primary keys have needed to be 60, like UN64. I think now it can also be string. So that's why, so this could also be, for example, the title, yeah? So that's why you need to write this primary key function. And then we're going to need the macro that comes with EOS. And we're going to need to tell this macro all the fields that it needs to serialize. Okay, and so we have defined our basic database structure. And now.
Can we add an I through a line?
Sorry?
Does it mean an I serialize?
Oh, yeah, thank you, thank you. The compiler would have caught it. Yeah. We're compiling.
Does it still work? Yes. It's just a name. Okay.
Okay, and we're going to define a type for our custom database index. And so EOS supplies this multi-index generic type. And we're going to create our own type based on this. And we're going to call it blog. And we're going to use the blog struct as an input, and we're going to call this log index, for example, and then we are going to create an instance of log index called logs. Okay, and then we should not forget to instantiate it. So let's do this like this, maybe. So we need this. So this requires this kind of initialization. And underscore self is the owner, yeah, of the contract. And I think this is almost something that we could compile already, but we need at least one action. We need to define at least one action. And we need to define an add log action. And it takes as first parameter the author, a second parameter the title string, a third parameter the HTML text. And then, so we are going to check, we're going to make sure that this transaction is signed by the author, that we have proper authorizations, and then we can create a database entry in the multi-index database that we just created, logs.mplace. And here, the first parameter, so if I choose self, this means that the storage that I'm using is built to the account, to the owner of the contract. If I want to charge this on to the author instead, I can put an author here. So it's really up to the developer of the application. So we're going to be nice and we're going to charge it to ourselves. So this will be a free service for the author. And then we can give this a lambda function. This, and this here means that we are going to capture the, in this lambda, we are going to capture the outside variables, so that in this lambda, I can access these variables from the outside. So I can write blog.id is blogs.available primary key. So this is going to give me a primary key that has not been used yet. And then I can assign the author, which is going to be just author, log.title, and so on, log.html. And I think that's it. See, on my cheat sheet, if I've done anything, yeah. So that should be it. And so we need just one thing. We need another macro down here before we can compile it. EOS.io_AVI example, which is the name of the contract. And then I need to give this macro all of my actions that I have here. And right now we have only one action, add block. And if I have not made any typos anywhere, this is something that we could compile. So let's try this. So let's take a look on our cheat sheet. Where was it? Anyway, so the command to compile is esio-cpp minus o example.wast, because we're going to create a WebAssembly file. And let's cross the fingers and see if we made any typos. Okay, so there is one error. Oh yeah, I think I screwed up the constructor here. There was a comma too much. Still, something is wrong. The comma was in the wrong spot. Yeah, I should maybe add that C++ is not my favorite language. Who here likes C++? Okay, so if I need help, I'm gonna ask you. Okay, so now 5 warnings generated. These are just warnings. We don't need to worry about this. So that's fine. So we have now successfully created our WebAssembly file. And now we need to create the ABI file. ABI.cpp. See if this works. And I think we forgot something, because this is an empty file now, because we forgot to annotate something. Because we need to annotate our structs here with an annotation. So the generator of the ABI can recognize that this is relevant for the ABI. Let's check the file and see. Yeah, this looks much better now. Yeah. So why do you actually need this ABI file? That's very simple, because this lets you map JSON, so you can interact with this contract in terms of a JSON, easy to write and read JSON format, and it's going to map this to these input parameters for the contract action. Yeah. All right. So we have successfully compiled everything that we need. Now we can start the blockchain. So I have. So I'm going to start the node. The EOS node with resync blockchain, which means it's going to delete everything. We're going to start with a totally fresh blockchain, and you can see it has started to generate blocks. Every 500 milliseconds, there's a new block being generated, and I have prepared commands needed to install everything. So when you have a totally fresh blockchain, you're going to need to first unlock the wallet list. So I have my default wallet unlocked now. Then we're going to deploy the BIOS contract. Of course, this is only something you need in testnet, just a command, and now the BIOS contract is deployed. And now we're going to create some users. Yes, so we're going to create an example user. And example this user account is going to be used to, this is where we are going to deploy the contract to. So our contract is called example, and we're going to create an EOS account with the name example that we're going to deploy the contract to. Example, and then we're going to create some more users. So I'm going to create an Angelo account as well, and a Peter account. And for now, we're just going to use the same key for all these, because we're just testing. Yeah? But of course, in reality, these would be different keys and different people. Yeah. So now we have created all the test accounts that we need. And this means we can now deploy the contract. And deploying the contract works like this. You say Cleos create contract, and then the account that you want to deploy it to, so example, and the contract directory. So, and when I hit enter, our contract is now deployed to the blockchain. We can check and see if our table is there, example, so with this command, we can check the contents of smart contract tables, and there's now a block table which is empty, because we have not put anything in it yet. And now we can put something in, and the way you do this is you say, in a transaction is, you say clears push action, and then the contract that you want to push to, so this is the accounting of the contract that you want to push the action to, and then the name of the action, and our action, if you recall, is called AdBlock. So this is the action that we're going to call. And then we can push, and then we have to supply a JSON data structure here with our parameters. So we can give these parameters here as a JSON structure. So it's first author, then title, and then the HTML. So author is, let's say it's Angelo, and then the title is my first blog, and the body just says hello world. Hello world. And so, and now I need to specify with whose permissions I want to sign this transaction. Yes? And let's try to sign this with Peter, with Peter's authorization. And this should now fail, because I said here, Angelo is the author. And in this code, we are checking require auth author. So if I say Peter here, this transaction should fail if we have made anything correctly. Yes. And correctly, it says missing authority of Angelo. Yeah? So I could now either change the author's name to Peter, or I could just give this the authorization of Angelo. And this works because I have the private keys in my wallet for this account. So let's try this again. Now we have no error. And now we can check the table again. And we have our first row in the table. Yeah. Let's create the second entry. Peter is also going to write his first blog post. Let's say Peter's first blog. Hello world from Peter. Angelo. Ah. Okay. So this escaping doesn't seem to work. This again, Peter's first blog. Hello world from Peter. So, yeah, and again, if I try to sign this with the wrong key, I get an error. I need to sign this with the authorization of Peter, and it gets successfully accepted by the node, and we have our second database entry. All right. So now we want to delete a block entry, and we're going to add a second action here. It's called remove block, and we're going to give this these parameters. So, and we're going to check that the sender has signed this. And now we're going to fetch this from the database. So we need to say logs.find ID. So this is how you get entries from the database. And then we're going to make sure that this is in fact a valid ID, that we actually found anything. we know that we have a valid ID. We can check if, in fact, this is the author. We're only going to allow the author himself to delete his own blog entries, yes? So we're going to check if the author equals sender. Only author is allowed to delete his own blogs. All right? And then we're actually going to delete stuff. So blogs.erase. Yeah, and that's it. This is now the method to delete a blog entry. And we must not forget to add this additional action down here to this macro. And now, if I have not made any typos, we can redeploy the contract. And as I said, on EOS, it's no problem to redeploy a contract for a second time. So we're just gonna call this clear set contract example directory again. And now it says contract is already running this version of code. Did I not save this? Ah, I'm in the wrong directory. Ah, I forgot, we need to compile it first. Sorry. So again, EOS.io, CPP, minus O example, dot wast, example, dot CPP. Okay, compiled successfully. And we're going to create the ADI file because we have added a new method. So we also need to recreate the ABI file, and now we can deploy it. Okay, and I'm not sure I understand fully why it says here that this contract is already running this version of code because we have changed it. Let me see. Yeah, we changed it. That's very interesting. Let's delete this. Recompile this. I'm stumped.
Maybe. Are you sure you're in the right directory? Because it's a dot dot slash example in the...
Yeah, maybe you prepared example in the first step. So
maybe I did. So maybe we're already running this version of the code. So, which is fine because this is what we want, all right? We can, to make sure, we can actually now add a print here. Says, well, hi, or something like that. Mm-hmm. No? We have a different problem.
I think you're in the wrong directory. Try go into the examples directory and execute the command from there.
Okay, this is strange. I didn't have this when I rehearsed this before, but it's always a different thing when you're sitting in front of so many people. So let's try it. So let's try to call the action, push action example remove blog. And we're going to say we are going to delete the block entry with the index number 0. And I need to sign this as well. And it was accepted. And as you can see, the first block entry has been deleted. So, so since this is a blockchain, you might be tempted to ask, when I delete something, where does it go? Is it really deleted? And the answer is, of course, it's still in the blockchain. It's just marked as deleted. And you're not going to see it here. And it is also removed from RAM. So I should maybe say that what we have here, this multi-index database, this is an in-memory database. Yeah. So when I delete this here, it means that the RAM that was used by this database table entry is going to be freed. And also the tokens that the amount of tokens that I needed to stake for this amount of memory, I can now get back. So applications need to be designed in a way that they can delete old unused data so you can reclaim some memory. Yeah? All right, and that's the full example. I hope this was, you could understand what was going on here. I hope, hope that was all right for you. As a bonus, if you're interested, I created also a user interface for this, which is a very simple HTML. Okay, so it's a very simple HTML that lets me create a block entry. So I can say Angelo, my second block, blah, blah, blah. And when I hit submit, let's see if it works. Yeah, so it's pushed this block entry to the blockchain and redirected me to a display page. And I can now, you can see it says here ID equals 2. So I can also say show me number 1. And then I get Peter's first block. Or I can try to access the block with entry with the ID 0, which we deleted earlier, and it's gone. And as you can see, this is really fast. So Peter, I hit and it's like really instant. And this is actually coming from the blockchain. So it's already mined. And somebody actually made a Space Invaders demo that you can that you could control over the blockchain with transactions. So, like moving the Space Invader back and forth as a demo. So it's that fast.
So I have a question.
Yes.
How do you interact with the blockchain from the HTML or JavaScript?
Ah, yeah. So I can show the code.
So,
yeah, so there is a library that is called EOS.js, which is the equivalent to the Web3 library that you know from Ethereum, and let me quickly run through the code with you. So the block.html is very simple, so it's just a very simple HTML, and then we have the eos.js include here, which is like the Web3 library, and then here I create, so I provide here my private key. I define the API endpoint and some variables, and then here here when I submit the form, I say eos.transaction. I submit the transaction to the blockchain, and then with the result, I'm doing something. Yeah, and when I want to fetch something from the blockchain, there's a function that says eos get table rows. Blah, 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 and then I get the result and I can do something with it. So it's fairly simple.
And do you need a node running on your local system to take this?
I have now a node running on my local system, but you don't need it. As I said, the block producers are going to create, so there's going to be public nodes that you can just use. But if you don't want to trust any of the public nodes. You can, of course, also install a local node. And you can configure it so it will only fetch the transaction relevant to your application. So you're not going to need 2 terabytes of RAM on your local system. Yeah. So it's going to build up the database only for the tape, like for your application. So if you're running, if you're a company and you're running a distributed application, you could install your own, you could run your own node and use that one for interacting with the blockchain. Or you can use a public one and use also some of this extra querying infrastructure that is going to be provided. I mean, we're not there yet because the mainnet is not even deployed yet, but in a couple of months we might see additional querying infrastructure around the core blockchain that distributed applications will be able to use. Similar in a way, for example, Steam is a blockchain, but it's running on the website is served from a centralized server, and they have an additional MongoDB and stuff like that where the actual data is for serving the customers. And there is also an MSSQL database run by the community, where like every 10 seconds, all the transactions are imported into the MSSQL database, and it lets you make SQL queries and so on. All right, so. Okay, so we have seen that smart contracts can be changed. And of course, then the question is a smart contract, can I still trust a smart contract if the developer can just go and deploy changes to the smart contract at will? And the answer is basically recurring contracts. So every trustworthy smart contract should have a recurring contract in the blockchain assigned to it. And what is a recurring contract? It's basically the terms and conditions, like it's basically the contract in legal prose, in a human understandable form. And in fact, a user interface could be markup. So a user interface, so let's say you're interacting with the dev and you buy something. The user interface could render this contract text and display it in the user interface, and there would be a button that says, yes, I agree to these terms. And when you click this button, you're going to sign this transaction with your private key, and it's abundantly clear that you agreed to these contractual terms. Yeah? And this is binding for the user, for all the parties, basically. Yeah, it's binding for legally binding for the user and also for the owner of the contract. Yeah. So what happens? So for example, this is a currency contract. Yeah. So what happens when after the contract has deployed, the owner changes this from 5% to 10%, and then all the inflation should go to his own account? Yeah. For this, we have on-chain arbitration, aka dispute resolution. And arbitrators are specially trained humans. So this is not an automated process, this is a process run by humans. And they're actually now, I think Block One is now helping find people who are qualified to do this. And this means, so if you have been victim to a scam like this, where the owner changed this contract after the fact, you can open an arbitration case. Yeah? And then it will be presented to human arbitrators, and then they will rule. Yeah? And if for example, they just fixed a bug in this code, And this was a legitimate change. They just fixed a bug. There was a DAO bug in it or something, and they just fixed it. Then the arbitrator would say, okay, yeah, but this was a, they just fixed a bug. This was a frivolous claim. Everything is okay. Or if they really made a change in the code that goes against this Ricardian contract, yeah, the arbitrator will most likely rule that, okay, in fact, this was a malicious change, and we're gonna have to revert it, you have to put it back, something like that.
So the arbitrators have the power to, if they're all in the same opinion, they can revert and contact to a previous...
Not the arbitrators themselves, the block producers can. Yeah? So the block producers, if like 15 of them agree, mm-hmm. they can, for example, 15 of the 21, if they agree, they can also put in arbitrary transactions or replace the code of existing smart contracts, things like that. And arbitrators are actually bound by arbitration decisions. So they are legally required to execute decisions by arbiters. So if an arbiter decides this contract was maliciously changed, please revert the state to the old thing, and so then the arbitrators must do it. And if an arbitrator, of course there is the possibility to appeal, okay? But if an arbitrator decides not to go along with a decision by an arbitrator, this is grounds for kicking out the block producer.
So, but of course, you can only roll back or like make the changes in their system, like reverted, right? But if the smart contract is connected to another blockchain, as you said before, if you use a smart contract to connect other blockchain, they will not be able to revert the other blockchain.
That's true. But if it's a public blockchain that is run by, so most likely what will happen is that these 21 block producers, they will not just run one blockchain, but they will run one mainnet and then 1,000 sidechains. And all of these will be governed by the same rules and laws as the main chain. Of course, if you deploy your own private blockchain within your company, the block users of the public blockchain can't do anything. Then it's your own business.
How many human arbitrators would check such a case? One, two, many? And how many does it need to, the votes of how many does it need to finally say, this is a change that has got to be
distributed, are they really?
I think this
I'm
is...
I'm sorry to know that, and they haven't been published.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this process is still in, like, the process of being set up, so it, not everything is totally documented about this. So that what little information I was able to gather here, I was able to from YouTube videos and so on. And they just recently, like a couple of weeks ago, they hired a person to find, train and train these human arbitrators, and they're they are working with some known arbitration agencies in London and stuff like that. So it's still in the process.
Why are they replicating something that already exists? There are very well established arbitration systems, legal systems that already do this.
Yeah, I'm not saying that they do it. They're doing something completely own.
No.
I think, in fact, they're working with established arbitrators. The only thing is, a normal arbitrator, as you probably can imagine, like a normal judge, they wouldn't know what a blockchain is. Yeah. So you would need to work with the existing system, and maybe select a few younger people who have some IT. I don't know how they will do it, but they're trying to establish a system. Yeah.
So when they're partying contract is set up, where the contract, under what legal jurisdiction, that can be arbitrated under?
There is an arbitration clause in the constitution, which means that You need to agree that not the public court is responsible, but there's an arbitration clause. So arbitration is binding for you legally.
What does it mean? UK versus Austria, United States versus Russia?
I don't know. I don't know. We'll find out.
How do we avoid that the system is flooded with...
You need to post a bond. You need to post a bond. When you want to open a case, and if for example the person just fixed a bug in the smart contract and yet you file an arbitration against this person and the arbitrator finds okay but they just fixed a bug, come on, then you lose your bond that you posted. Okay. So for example you have to post 1,000 euros. Or 100 EOS tokens or whatever, then this bond is gone. Yeah.
Can this be used for bugs that are already in the code that are not fixed yet? So if you have a bug that has a bug in, the money is gone somehow, and can somebody call an arbitration case out of that?
Yeah. So if the damage has already been done,
so
there was an undiscovered bug in the smart contract and its money was lost. Parity hack,
yeah.
Whatever. Yes. If the money is still there somehow, the arbitrators could say, okay, we're going to return this money to their rightful owners.
So it's not only for changes of the DAPs, it's only from the existing DAPs that can be cases of arbitration.
Yeah, so for example, if in something like with the DAO hack, so okay,
yeah.
There's a bug, so first what they're going to do is they're going to fix the bug, so they're going to redeploy the contract with a fixed code, and then, if possible, they will issue... they will tell the block producers, please return this money to their rightful owners. And then what is done is, it is not like that the chain will be rolled back or something like that, but there will be like
patches.
So additional transactions of money will be inserted that return the money from this account, blah, 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 blah.
Who is doing this?
To their rightful owners, the block producers.
The block producers.
Yes, so the arbitrator rules, okay, this money needs to be returned to their rightful owners. Please see to it that they get it. And then the block producers go and transfer the money.
But they could still refuse to do that?
No. No. I mean, they could. They could. But that would be reason for them to be voted out. Because when in the block producer agreement, initially when they become block producers, they need to agree to the fact that they are bound by arbitration decisions. So when an arbitrator says this and this needs to be done, normally they have to do it.
Is there any compensation for arbitrators?
Yes, obviously, yeah.
So every change in a contract on mainnet will cost something only for arbitrators?
No. I, as a developer, I can redeploy my contract as often as I want. I can fix bugs every day if I want to. Only when somebody in the community opens an arbitration case against me and says, okay, this was a malicious change in the contract, then an arbitrator is going to step in.
Okay, so yeah? Minor issues might get undiscovered, but it doesn't make any real issue because it's small, but in the big case, then there will be a hijack, so there will be...
Yeah, I mean, somebody needs to open an arbitration case. I mean, it's the same thing. When I hit you, the police is not going to come and arrest me. They're only going to come if you file an unsigned against me. Yeah.
Are arbitrators bound to decisions which are historically already done? So is there a case law or is it any decision on a single case?
I don't know that, it would be as in the traditional arbitration system.
That's separate, the traditions compete each other. The American system against the
I don't know. I don't know. We will see. We have to wait. Let's see.
And what if I'm writing to my browser contract that my contract is not arbitrary? Is arbitration, so that has only.
I don't think that's possible.
So that's the difference between the browser and the technically.
I don't think that's possible. I mean, you could. I mean, the terms of the contract could be very wide, very unspecific, and I guess. But then it's as in real life as well. I mean, would you sign a rental agreement that says the owner can increase the rent anytime by any amount? No, you wouldn't sign this in real life. So you shouldn't sign this on a blockchain either.
So I think could that be written in the constitution somewhere that it's not possible to make a Ricardian contract that does not allow for arbitration?
I'm not sure if it's somewhere in the constitution. I mean, we don't even know how the constitution will look like exactly. There are a couple of drafts, but in the end, the community decides which of these drafts are going to be launched in the mainnet, basically. Yeah. So block one delivers, together with the EOS.io software, they deliver a couple of example constitutions, but in the end, the community is the one who decides what's going to be in the constitution.
Is there maybe like a time limit of in which you can this arbitration can be done? Because I think if there is not, or even if there is, that would prolong like the. Now in Bitcoin you have 6 block confirmation and you can be sure that it's yours, like much. But then, I don't know, maybe I'm buying some tokens and then like in the NEM hack it was stolen and then maybe this takes some weeks and then after 2 months my tokens are gone because the arbitrators have decided to get it back from me, although I just innocently bought it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is a very good question. And the answer is, it would be the same as in the real world. So for example, if you buy a bicycle from a bike shop in good faith, and then 2 days later the police comes and says, ha, this bike was stolen, you will still be able to keep it because you bought it in good faith. But if they can prove that you knew that it was stolen when you bought it, you have to give it back. So that's how it would be handled in real life, basically, more or less. And this is how it would also be on the blockchain.
Stolen goods, if you buy stolen goods, you lose the stolen goods.
Yes. No, that's not the case.
It depends on its jurisdiction.
It's like if you receive a counterfeit bill. It's like you lose the bill, no one's going to give you,
I mean, at least in Austria, this is the case.
Yeah. It is the case in Austria. I studied law. And there's 3 exceptions where you can get something in good faith. Yeah. It's when you get it from an auction, when you get it from an entrepreneur, like the bicycle shop.
Yes.
And that was a 3rd reason. But what you said is basically is correct.
Okay. Yeah, so it's the chain of law. So it would be as in real life, just on the blockchain.
But then it would be like a global
jurisdiction. Yeah, that's a very good question. Which is the exact jurisdiction that applies to you? I don't know exactly how they. We're gonna see. I mean, we have to wait a couple of weeks, I think. But it's a very interesting topic because this is new, and I don't think this has been done before on any blockchain to sort of try to build a bridge into the real world.
There is a Russian system, Yuri.online. It's an arbitration system for ICOs and investors, and they have similar problems, similar questions.
So it's a really, really interesting topic. Really interesting experiment.
Another question about the staking of the token. So let's say that this contract we did would be that I have to pay when I want to enter the block. So do I have to stake the token previously, or will it be automatically?
The process? normally you would have your token staked anyways.
Okay.
Yeah? So for example, when the chain is launched and you get your initial allocation of tokens from the ERC20 distribution, the tokens are gonna be staked already. And if you want to get them out, sell them, you need to unstake them, wait 3 days, you get them back, you can sell them. But normally you would have them in a staked contract somewhere for security reasons alone. Because as long as they are staked, nobody can steal them from you. Okay? So even if somebody gets your private key and they try to transfer the money out, they would have to publish this intent to transfer your tokens out onto the blockchain. And you would be able to see it. And you have 3 days to react to it, to say, okay, this is not me, somebody stole my private key, I want to cancel this transaction.
But what happens after I remove the stake? So I'm selling them. What happens with the data that are in the block tab, in the database? They are removed?
You first need to delete the data from your database.
I need to do that.
Yes.
But I need to know the interface. For example, you made the first approach was without the option to delete it. So that they would be stuck in there or not?
It depends, as far as I know, it depends on the dApp. So if the dApp charges the storage on the users, then if it's a good dApp, they should provide the user a way to delete their data so that all the storage that they used within this app is reclaimed and they can unstake their tokens.
So I can't unstake the token if there's something bound to it. So that's how I
understood it. And in fact they changed it recently the way RAM is allocated, because before you had to stake a certain amount of tokens for smart contract storage. Now you actually need to buy RAM. There will be a RAM market. There's going to be like an exchange where you can buy RAM with EOS, and when you stop using the RAM, you can sell it again to somebody else. And you can actually trade RAM. So you can buy RAM cheaply and sell it for a higher price. That's a very funny system, yeah.
How does, can one still become a block producer, and if yes, how does the process work? So do I have to buy the hardware first and then apply as a block producer, or?
Anyone can apply as a block producer, but of course your chances of getting elected will be very slim if you don't even have the hardware yet. So as far as I know, all the block producers that are right now the candidates, they have the hardware already running. Mm-hmm. And they're already actively in the process of practicing the mainnet launch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they already have 21 block producers.
Yeah, I mean they have I think 50 or 60 right now, more or less. And only 21 of those will become the top producers, and the rest will become standby producers. And the standby producers will also be paid, but a little bit less. And the number of standby producers that are going to get money is a limited amount. I don't know exactly, they changed it recently.
Mm-hmm. And is there, how much money do you need to stake to get enough hardware capacity, and
you don't need to stake any EOS tokens. You don't need to own any EOS tokens if you want to become a block producer. Anyone can.
Yeah, but you need to buy the
hardware.
But
you need to have the hardware and manpower and knowledge to operate the data center, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And how much money can
one block producer, EOS New York, they made a calculation and they actually have a sheet online. It's open source, an Excel sheet, and they calculated that in order to operate this infrastructure, you need $1 million per year. Mm-hmm. In servers, in staff, stuff like that.
from this block order?
Yeah, I mean the idea is of course that that it should be profitable to run a block producer. Yeah. Please.
How can they need to get all stakeholders vote for the block producers? But how can I, if I were a stakeholder, how would I inform myself for whom to vote?
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's a very good question. There are there's a forum that's called EOS Go that's collecting information on all block producers. They have set up sort of like a Bewertungsmatrix or criteria matrix that every block producer needs to fulfill a certain amount of criteria. They're trying to collect this. Every block producer needs to publish like a weekly statement on Steam. So it's in the blockchain, so it's auditable, transparent, and stuff like that. So they're trying to, I mean, the EOS blockchain is not there yet. In the future, probably someone will develop something on the EOS blockchain, because the voting process will be ongoing. Yeah, so you can change your vote anytime. And of course, there are always new block producers potentially coming in who want to fetch votes from the other block producers. So it's going to be a constant voting process. So it's like in actual politics as well. You need to basically inform yourself. Mm-hmm. Right now, it's right now. But I agree. Right now, it's not probably not as transparent and decentral as it could be. Mm-hmm. But it will hopefully change in the future.
I mean, in Shift or Lisp, it's for instance, they share the block reward, right? So what's keeping the EOS delegates from sharing the reward and by this giving a motivation for the voters?
Yeah, so this is one of the deadly sins in the EOS law system. So it's forbidden by the constitution explicitly to buy votes, and also in the block producer agreement. And if you catch any block producer doing this, this is like very serious offense.
Did they clarify what is considered to be like a cashback payment? Because I remember like a month or two ago we had a discussion that what is considered what happens if I just hire a whale as a CTO of my company and he votes for my block producer, and then I just give him a cut of whatever I earn as block producer. Did they cut it?
Yeah, there are some rules that owners of the block producers must not have over 0.1% of the tokens or something like that. Mm-hmm. So there are some rules against this.
But there was a block producer that airdropped something on
That was actually so the story behind this is, so there is a block producer who is called EOS DAC, and DAC standing for Distributed Autonomous Community. So they are organized as a DAO basically, and they airdrop the token to all EOS stakeholders with the intention of sharing their profits potentially with their token holders.
And
so
this is traded.
And it's traded, it's being traded. It's 20 cents or something. and there was a discussion, is this bribery? So are they in fact buying tokens? And I think it's a fine line, because technically no. If you define buying votes as a quid pro quo thing, then no, because everybody got the tokens. They dropped the tokens on everybody, whether or not they voted for them. So no, it's not vote buying. They're just being very generous. But it was a smart thing to do. And they got away with it.
As we talked before, there's the date of June the 1st, where all the tokens that are still in still running, they have to be changed.
Yeah.
This for my
Who has EOS tokens? Okay, and who of you have registered their tokens already? Who has not registered them? Okay. So then you need to hurry up. So the way it works is, as you know, there are currently ERC-20 tokens on Ethereum because the ICO was conducted on Ethereum. And it's in fact still running, I think, until tomorrow or something like that. And so what they're going to do is, on June 1st, the contract is going to lock itself up, which means the tokens will no longer, you will no longer be able to transfer the tokens. They're going to be frozen. Okay? And on the June 2nd, the community is going to launch the mainnet. And what they're going to do is they will run an Ethereum node and import the token distribution from Ethereum into the Genesis block of EOS. Yeah? So if you hold any EOS tokens right now on Ethereum, you are also going to automatically have them on EOS, but, and here comes the but, you need to generate a public-private key pair, so you need to generate an EOS private key now, and then register the public key with the Ethereum smart contract. And when you have done that, and of course the private key you're going to keep to yourself, you register the public key. And when you have done that, you can sit back and relax and watch the mainnet being launched, because then when it is up and running, you automatically have your tokens. If you then log into the wallet with the private key that you generated, you're going to see, hopefully, the exact amount of tokens that you had previously on Ethereum. You're going to see them in your wallet. That's how it works.
In which wallet? Is there already a wallet? Because you were
referring. Yeah, there are several community wallets developed. I mean, so there's a command line wallet. Yeah, so there's a command line wallet included in the EOS.io software that you can use. And there are several community developed wallets, web interfaces and stuff like that. There is also something like MetaMask. It's called Scatter. EOS.com, and this also has a wallet included. Right. So let's see if I had any more slides. Oh yeah, that was almost it. And so the mainnet has not launched yet, but we already. Okay, we already have. A lot of applications, so this is just a small subjective selection of mine, dApps that I think are interesting or notable. So we have Everpedia, which is a decentralized Wikipedia that has sort of a prediction market built in for curating the articles. Bancor, that you probably know from Ethereum, that is currently also running on Ethereum. They announced that they will also run their exchange also on EOS. Then Bitfinex is going to launch a decentralized exchange on EOS. And then Chintai is a token leasing platform. So as I said, if you are an app developer, a dApp developer, and you need tokens, you can rent them basically through this marketplace from users. And if you are an EOS holder, if you have tokens, that you don't need yourself, you can lease them out on this platform and generate income through it. Then there is a Chinese social network, Ono, that seems very interesting. Then there is a Frick, it's a marketplace for 3D printing data. This one is actually from Austria, so I find that very interesting. Then there's Higher Vibes, basically Monster or the decentralized dot platform. And this is also very interesting because they're also gonna airdrop to EOS token holders, and they're gonna share their profits with those token holders as well. If that makes them a security or not, I don't know, but that's how it is. And this will be very interesting to see. And then also something that I found very interesting, Zimbra X. They are sort of like a cloud email enterprise, emails, collaboration system provider. They are going to launch some kind of enterprise email and collaboration platform on EOS. And this will be very interesting to see how they do it. Because I personally wouldn't want my emails on a public blockchain. So it will be very interesting to see how they do it. All right, so that was it from my slides so far. Thank you very much. If you have any more questions, yes, please.
What's the takeaway now of the community about block producers being like Bitfinex wanted to get a block producer spot, Huobi wanted to get block producer spot? Is it already resolved? Are they allowed to do it? Because I remember it was like a huge buzz back then when Huobi announced that they're going to run.
I mean, there's no one. It's not. There's no centralized entity that could say no. We are not. We will not allow Bitfinex to become a block producer. Yeah, which means if they want to become block producer, if they fulfill the criteria, if they apply, you will be able to vote for them.
And they will be going to vote for themselves with the money.
No. I mean, Bitfinex actually did it in a smart way. So first of all, the constitution and the block producer agreements forbids it. So you are only allowed to vote for tokens that you own beneficially for yourself. So you are not allowed to vote with tokens that you hold custodially for somebody else, which means an exchange. If you catch an exchange voting with their exchange wallet, you can open a quite nice arbitration case there. Because you will get a certain amount of those tokens in the wallet if you win the arbitration case. So this could be very bad for the block for the exchange if they do it, and could be very good for you if you catch them doing it. And Bitfinex actually they will offer a tool, a voting tool, to their users. So if I let's say I have 100 EOS tokens in my wallet on Bitfinex, then I can log in and say, okay, I want to vote for these block producers with my 100 tokens.
But then I can't trade them anymore, so that would be just like in the lending platform, you need to
remove them
from the trading wallet.
I guess you would, if you sell them, you would not, you would probably, you would unvote, probably. Yeah, because the exchange.
I will have multiple wallets. One is for trading, and then you need to move them over to a different wallet where you say you stake them for.
Yeah,
3 days.
I mean, I don't exactly know how the exchange will do it.
Technically, I don't.
Because normally the exchange would keep the tokens like in one or several wallets that are going to be staked for security reasons. And so on, and they would have a complicated system. So I don't exactly know how they will do it, but I'm sure they're gonna come up with something.
Is your example code going to be available online?
Yes, I will post the link on the Meetup comments page. Any Ethereum people here who wanna throw some?
Yes, I have a question. What's the advantage of having a blockchain if I have to trust to the developer of the smart contract? If the developer can at any time change the code, I have to trust as a user. I have to trust to the developer because you can change all the time the contract, the code, no?
Yeah, I mean, okay, so first of all, there is going to be the possibility so I can forfeit my right to change the code if I want to. Yeah? So I can, if I want to, I can make an EOS contract that I cannot update anymore. So this is a possibility. Yeah? And for certain types of applications, developers are probably going to do it to be more trustworthy. Okay? For other types of applications, it makes more sense to be able to update the code. Okay? For example, if you are a social network, you probably want to update the code regularly, at least twice a week when the new app is in the App Store.
What's the advantage then to Facebook, for example, if Facebook gets a... But,
yeah, what's the purpose of decentralization? I can run my
server
in cloud and it's also decentralized.
Just a second. And the second part, and the second answer to your first question would be, as I explained with the Ricardian contracts and stuff, there's a governance system in place that ensures that as a developer, you cannot simply change a contract in a malicious way as easily. Of course, you need to trust in this arbitration and governance
process. But
it's
the same like in real life, no? Then there's no difference to Facebook, no? If I can also sue Facebook if they steal my data or share my data, whatever. It's the same principle, no? I mean.
Yeah, but it's everything is in the blockchain and everyone can see it. It's a difference. It's a very open and transparent system. So if you are going to commit fraud on a blockchain, it's not a very good idea. It's not a very good idea to commit fraud and tell somebody on the telephone about it. Not much less doing it openly on the blockchain. It's a very, very bad idea because the fraud that you're committing will be openly visible for everyone. For every judge, for every court, for the police, for everyone.
You are not always able to revert that change. It's not like I did something bad and okay, now someone can revert it just like that. It's not always possible, no?
Yeah, and maybe I should say I don't think EOS means that Ethereum is now obsolete and we will not use it anymore. I think both systems have their reason for being here, and for certain types of applications where you need this extra bit of trust and censorship resistance, you're probably going to need use Ethereum, and for an application like a social network or something like that, or a marketplace or something, you probably want to use EOS because it's faster, it supports a larger number of users, stuff like that. That's my opinion, at least.
You had the example of the Bitfinex voting for itself using the users' wallets, and you said that if you find, if you report this, you can get some tokens from arbitration. Is this a general thing that you incentivize whistleblowers?
As far as I understood it, yes. I mean, I don't know the specifics, how it works, what's the percentage, how much money you get, but generally users are incentivized to report fraud, so they will get some kind of reward. But I don't know exactly how it works. I don't think it has been published yet.
But that also means that bug bounties, you know, you find a bug in a dump and you report it, then it's somehow wrong?
No, I don't think, no. A bug would not be an arbitration case. Because you cannot open an arbitration case saying, hey, I found a bug in this software. Then the arbitrator would say, okay, why don't you tell the developer that there's a bug so they can fix it?
Might be an interesting idea for the contract developers to incentivize this bug reporting or bug hunting.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, yes, that's a very, very good point. So Article 4 of your recording contract, of your smart contract, could state bug bounty, everyone who finds a valid bug will get 100 EOS tokens from us. And if you then report a bug, then you would get it.
Is there a library for accessing or writing oracles already?
There's a dApp that is called Oracle Chain, I believe, launching on EOS and going to provide oracle services. Okay, so if there aren't any more questions, this concludes the official part of the evening. And I don't know if the pizza is here yet.
It is here.
Yes. Ah, it's here. Okay, then why are we still talking? All right, so, and oh, and by the way, I know before you go into pizza, I want to say a few last words. I know a few projects are looking for developers. So if you want to work as a developer in this field, if you're interested, get in touch.